So,
good afternoon, everyone.
Now, in the last class, we were talking about Bengal, right? We started discussion on the Battle of Plassey, right? Now, Battle of Plassey, we discussed the major events leading up to the battle. Now, what we are going to do is firstly talk about the causes of the Battle of Plassey, and then we'll talk about some of the events that followed after the Battle of Plassey and led to the Battle of Buxar. So don't write in the timeline that we were writing, right? We have written till 1757, leave another page there because we'll complete it till 1764, okay? We'll complete it till there. And only later we'll, so leave a page, we'll come back to it, okay? And we'll write the causes on a separate page. So this is again to differentiate that events are different from causes. And again, don't always think that they're the same, okay? And because when you're revising later, you can have the whole chain of events from the start till the end in one go, okay? And you can look at the causes separately, okay? So let's talk about the causes on the basis of the events that we have discussed till now. So in terms of the causes, you should firstly know that we talk in terms of causes in most of the cases, to the extent possible, we talk in terms of political and economic causes, okay? And yes, even here, we can talk in that sense. But also, so for example, when we talk about the interests of the Jagat Seth brothers, that they felt that their economic interests would be hampered, that is what, an economic cause? Or we talk about the political cause, is the emergence of the succession dispute after the death of Ali Wardi Khan, right? So we talked about that how after the death of Ali Wardi Khan between Ghaziti Begum and Siraj-ud-Daula, there's a political dispute, succession dispute which emerges. So that is also, all of this story is beginning only after the death of Ali Wardi Khan. So as long as there is a strong central ruler, there is no such political dispute which allow the British to try and increase their influence, or the Jagat Seth brothers giving ideas to Jagat Seth brothers that they could increase their influence. So all of this is happening after the death of Ali Wardi Khan and the emergence of the succession dispute. So that is a political cause, right? Another political cause is also the friction between Jagat Seth brothers and Siraj-ud-Daula, as the young Nawab was more assertive in his approach than what the Jagat Seth brothers were comfortable with, right? So that is also a political cause. In economic cause, we can say that one economic cause is the threat that the Jagat Seth brothers perceive to their economic interests. The other economic cause is also what? Is the Anglo-French rivalry, as both wanted a trading monopoly in the region, because if they had the trading monopoly, they would have greater economic profits, right? If the British were only the traders, then there would be no competition from the French and they would be able to capture the market better. Similarly for the French. So there is the economic interest is, or the economic cause is also the rivalry between the British and the French. So that aspect is also there, right? So in this context, what you particularly see that you can write like this also, political and economic causes, and it is ultimately the same, or you can write directly other causes, you know, directly as we are going to discuss. So in my sense here, it's better that if you write only in terms of the causes that we are discussing. Later we can group them up in political and economic causes, okay? So in terms of causes, we say the first major cause is the lack of, or one could say, the absence of a strong central ruler after the death of Ali Wardi Khan. That resulted in the emergence of succession dispute, right? This is one cause, and you can elaborate on this further with the whole things that we have written before in the events already, right? About Ghaziti Begum and Siraj-ud-Daula, etc. Then another major cause for this whole issue emerging is the Anglo-French rivalry, not just in the economic domain, but also the imperial rivalry between the English and the French. Now here, the rivalry is not merely in economic interest between the French East India Company and the British East India Company. Yes, there is economic rivalry, but there is a larger imperial rivalry at play also, that both want to increase their influence in as many regions. The British Empire and the French Empire both want to increase their influence. So that is also the competition which is driving their increasing engagement in the region, and which also becomes a part of the politics of the region. So, and it is here that the Anglo-French rivalry, the Anglo-French rivalry to the Anglo-French rivalry to increase their imperial presence in the region saw both sides making attempts the Anglo-French rivalry to increase their imperial presence in the region saw both sides making attempts to influence the domestic polity of Bengal to obtain trading monopolies and drive out their European competition out of Bengal. So that is another cause. Apart from this, apart from these two causes, you see the third major cause is the assertive policies of the young Nawab Siraj ud-Daula which threatened the hold of Jagat Seth, the assertive policies of the young Nawab Siraj ud-Daula, which threatened the hold of the Jagat Seth brothers. Over the court of Bengal and its economic policies. And fourth is the perceived threat to British economic interests as Siraj seemed unwilling
to grant British a trading monopoly in the region
. The next line that I'm writing, I'll explain it later as we discuss Hyderabad after this.
The British feared being outsmarted by the French, the British East India Company feared being outsmarted by the French East India Company, as was the case in Hyderabad or Carnatic region at this time.
These are the causes. Clear?
Now, these are the causes for the Battle of Plassey. Now, these are the causes for the Battle of Plassey. And when we'll talk about the Battle of Buxar, we'll add, I don't think so that they'll ask you in the mains examination separately the causes for Battle of Plassey or separately a question for Battle of Buxar. They will ask you a question like this, that discuss the factors which triggered a conflict between European powers and the state of Bengal and its implications for 18th century India. So, Battle of Plassey and Buxar, their causes are interrelated. These all are the causes of Battle of Plassey. What happens after this leads to the Battle of Buxar, and we'll talk about it. Okay. Now, let's first talk about the impact of Battle of Plassey. The impact of Battle of Plassey is that Mir Jafar is coming to the throne. Okay, and let's firstly complete the timeline that we were doing, then we'll come to the writing the impacts and everything later. Okay, so we had written till 1757, right? Now we'll take it forward from 1757 to 1764. Okay, now firstly, whenever you win a war and you impose a defeat on your opponent, you extract a cost for it. Okay. You extract a cost for it, and to that extent, and extracting a cost for it was something that the British East India Company also aimed to do, and that is why they resorted to something that was called in 1757, they resorted to something that was called as the Plassey plunder. This you can add to the timeline that we were doing. That in 1757, the British resorted to what was called as the Plassey plunder. In the Plassey plunder, the British actually imposed huge financial costs on Bengal. They held the British held Bengal as responsible for initiating the war. They held, and since Bengal was defeated, they expected Bengal to pay a huge financial compensation for starting the war. Though the war did not last long, it was merely a surrender. But the British imposed huge financial costs on Bengal, and this is what is termed as the Plassey plunder. So, firstly, under the Plassey plunder, an immediate war indemnity or war compensation, it's one and the same thing. An immediate war indemnity of 2,75,000 pounds was to be paid by Bengal to the British East India Company. Okay. A war compensation of 2,75,000 was to be paid in 1757 immediately as a result of this defeat. Secondly, they said that over the next 4 years, from 1757 to 1760, Over the next four years, the British East India Company demanded 22.5 million rupees as a war compensation. Okay. So, in the 22, that between 1757 to 1760, the British East India Company demanded that Bengal must pay ₹22.5 million. Okay. Now, basically, what do you see in these two things? That the British East India Company is trying to make a huge financial gain out of the war. Right? It is trying to make a huge financial gain out of the war by imposing these costs on whom? Bengal. And in Bengal, the Nawab is whom? Mir Jafar now. Mir Jafar had helped to overthrow the, you know, had helped to overthrow Siraj. And basically Mir Jafar becomes a Nawab. Now Mir Jafar realizes if that Bengal has to pay such a huge revenue demand to the British, this would leave little in the finances of the state itself. And this would leave little with the state itself. So Mir Jafar is not very keen on meeting these demands. Okay, and especially this demand of ₹22.5 million. So though Mir Jafar has made the Nawab, he is unwilling to comply with the huge financial demands made by the British. The result is that Mir Jafar was replaced by Mir Qasim. Mir Jafar is replaced by Mir Qasim, who goes on to become the next Nawab. And he is expected to comply with these financial obligations already imposed. Okay, he is expected to comply with these financial obligations already imposed by whom? By the British. Now, so you can write that here, that Mir Jafar failed to comply with the huge revenue demands made by the British East India Company, and thus he was replaced. By Mir Qasim. Thus he was replaced by Mir Qasim in 1760. Okay. Now in 1760 Mir Qasim comes to power. Now Mir Qasim is also, though Mir Qasim comes to power, he also faces the same situation, that complying with the huge revenue demands made by the British would leave his empire, or would leave Bengal with little source of revenue. And to that extent, this is something that they are not very keen on complying with either. Now, but what can Mir Qasim do? If Mir Qasim also refuses to comply, then this would do what? It would result probably in his own, in his overthrow as well. Right? So Mir Qasim understands that there is not much scope of not complying with British demands, and that, and not complying with British demand will have its consequences. So the solution to this, he argues, is that we should do something. We should overthrow the British presence in the region, or we should remove the British presence from Bengal. And this is where he is, this is where you see the beginning of the Battle of Buxar. Okay, this is where you see the beginning for the planning of the Battle of Buxar, where you see that in Awadh, in Bengal and in Delhi. Basically, Bengal was the one where the British already had the trading monopoly. Now, and the British had the trading monopoly, and the British had imposed huge financial costs on Bengal. Who was watching this closely? Awadh. If Bengal, if in Bengal the British had established their presence, it was quite much expected that Avadh was also a prosperous Mughal province. Given that it was in the northern plains and the plains of Ganga, Avadh was also a prosperous Mughal province. It was quite much expected. It was quite much expected by Avadh that if in Bengal they wanted trading monopoly, they would seek trading monopoly in Avadh also. And trying to seek trading monopoly in Avadh, they will also try to influence the domestic politics of Avadh to increase their influence in the region. Okay, that was the realization within Avadh also, that what had happened in Bengal can happen any day in Avadh as well, whenever the situation is right. So, in that context, Avadh at this point of time is ruled by the brother of Siraj, cousin brother of Siraj, and that is Shuja-ud-Dawla. In Delhi, it was, I mean, these names are not that important, Shah Alam II. And in Bengal, we know it was Mir Qasim. In Bengal, it was Mir Qasim. So, Mir Qasim led the efforts to join hands with Avadh and the central Mughal ruler, Shah Alam II. And a joint military offensive was prepared by Delhi, Avadh and Bengal against the British. And this is what led to the Battle of Buxar in 1764. Okay. So, now it is in this context that you see that Delhi, Avadh and Bengal coming together was a joint military offensive against the British forces. However, in the Battle of Buxar, the joint military offensive led by Mughal successor states turned out to be unsuccessful. If it would have been successful, then the British would have been thrown out. So, obviously, this was unsuccessful. And in the Battle of Buxar, the forces of the Mughal successor states were defeated. But now will come the question, sir, how is it possible that the British East India Company, a private trading company, can go ahead and defeat the combined forces of Avadh and Bengal together, right? And the involvement of the central Mughal ruler is also there, but it is largely ceremonial in nature because the largest fighting units were contributed by Avadh and Bengal. So, what can explain the defeat of successor Mughal states to the British even when they are joining hands? The answer for this comes from that firstly, these successor Mughal states are not fighting the British East India Company, they are fighting the British Army. They are fighting the British Army. Now, the British Army had come into India not to fight Bengal and Avadh. The British Army had actually come into India at this time in Hyderabad. And in Hyderabad, the British Army had come to fight the French Army. See, wherever the French East India Company was a government-owned trading company. Remember I told you, right? The French East India Company was a government-owned trading company. Wherever the company went, it was accompanied by the forces of the French Empire. And we'll see when we'll discuss Hyderabad that the British East India Company was not accompanied. Okay, the British East India Company was not accompanied by the British forces. It was a private trading company. But when the French started attacking the British trading positions in Hyderabad, the British East India Company now appealed to their government in Britain to send in additional troops. And that is when the British troops came into India, primarily firstly in the Hyderabad region, to tackle the French. But as they came here to defend British economic interests in Hyderabad, they were also deployed in Bengal, in the Battle of Plassey also and in the Battle of Buxar also. So, first thing you have to understand, they are not fighting the East India Company, they are fighting the British Army. Secondly, the British Army forces were led by one general. Okay, so in terms of coordination and organization, the British forces were a unified lot. Whereas in case of the regional states coming together, their armies were led by their respective, leadership coming from different princely states. And it was not that in terms of cohesion also of leadership, there was not one unified command as it is said. In the British, there was a unified command, whereas here there was not a unified command. A unified command meaning all the orders are coming from one authority from the top. Here, the forces of Awadh are coordinating with the forces of Bengal. It's not that there is one commander who is leading the joint forces of Awadh and Bengal. So even in terms of coordination, the British forces were superior. And finally, also, as I told you, in terms of technology, right, that there is no major technological modernization introduced since the time of Aurangzeb. So whether it is in technological modernization, whether it is in terms of efficiently coordinating a response, or it is in terms of tackling the British army, the Indian states fell short. And this is the reason why they were defeated in the Battle of Buxar at the hands of the British army. Now, as they get defeated in the Battle of Buxar, you see that in 1764, this is followed by the Treaty of Allahabad, right? Now, in the Treaty of Allahabad, which happened at this point of time, from your prelims point of view, it is important to note, what are the provisions of the Treaty of Allahabad, okay? That is something that is important to note, okay? Now, firstly, and the significance of this, we'll study from Maine's point of view. What is the significance of these battles of Plassey and Buxar? So, firstly, as a result of the Treaty of Allahabad, the first thing that they do is, dekhe, yahan pe they impose a war compensation on Bengal. So, now they will impose a war compensation on Awadh, right? Awadh was to pay a war compensation of 5 million rupees. 5 million rupees was an immediate war compensation that Awadh was expected to pay, okay? Secondly, they have trading monopoly in Bengal. They already have trading monopoly, and this is something that we'll write here, Abhi. They already had trading monopoly in Bengal. They got the trading monopoly rights in Bengal with the Plassey plunder, okay? They're getting, isi ke chakkar mein toh pura bawal hua hai, right? All the conflict is starting with the issue of trading monopoly. Right, so they are getting the trading monopoly in Bengal with the Plassey plunder. Now they will say that we want trading monopoly in where? Awadh. Kyunki Bengal mein to they already have. So okay, from Awadh they've got trading monopoly. From Awadh they've got a war compensation. But Bengal is also involved in the war. In fact, Bengal is the key instigator of the war. So Bengal also will have to pay an additional price. What is that price? Exactly. That Bengal already is trying to pay a huge war compensation, right? Now, apart from war compensation monopoly rights already that Bengal has given, they are now saying that Bengal must provide what? That Bengal must provide something important. And that is that from Bengal they wanted revenue collection rights. From Bengal they want revenue collection rights. Why revenue collection rights from Bengal? Primarily because Bengal had a huge amount, had a flourishing economy, right? And so, and had high agricultural productivity. So revenue generated from Bengal would be significant. So they demanded Diwani rights from Bengal, meaning that a portion of the revenue collected from Bengal would be going to the British East India Company. Now, war compensation will come once, but once you get revenue collecting rights, it will become a permanent source of revenue, right? So, the East India Company is coming as a private trading company, but now is moving in the direction of becoming a, of becoming an organization which is not being behaving merely as a trading group, but is also developing long-term economic stakes in the region, okay? And is behaving not merely as a trading group with getting Diwani rights. They are having a interest in the administration of the region also, okay? But they are only taking an interest in the revenue administration to begin with. So, as they get the Diwani rights, in Bengal, we say that the Treaty of Allahabad, with the Treaty of Allahabad, there is a dual system of administration which begins in Bengal. Under this dual system of administration, the rule still happened in the name of the Nawab. The day-to-day administrative aspects were also looked over by the Nawab and the rulers and the native rulers of Bengal. However, in terms of revenue collection, the East India Company was to have a significant say. So this is a dual system of administration that comes after the Treaty of Allahabad. So that is why we say that with the Battle of Plassey and Buxar, the British started establishing their indirect rule in Bengal. But aap puchenge ki sir, why indirect rule? If they have defeated Bengal, then why should they settle only for indirect rule?
Language,
people will revolt. Dil mange more. Why not dil mange more? Why only settle for indirect rule? The major reason is that the East India Company is a private trading company. Why should it take over the administration of the state and the responsibilities when come with it when you are already getting the money? Aap soch nahi rahe company ki tarah. Why should I take up the additional burden of administration if I am already getting what one will get after administration? If you have rights without any responsibilities of administration, if you are making economic gains without any taking over any headache of administration, then that is a better deal to have. Also, it does something important. Rather than the local people revolting, it is important to know that the British also were sensible, or the British East India Company realized that if they were to completely displace the local rulers, they will again rise and protest. So even after defeating the opponent or the local native rulers, the British would leave them with enough authority so that they have an incentive to cooperate with the British. Okay? If a total displacement would happen, then they would continue to revolt against the British. And if that is not, and if they are allowed to retain their privileges, then rule will still happen in their name. They have every incentive to come to a negotiation or a settlement with the British. So the British East India Company is doing this rather than displacing the local rulers, because it would trigger more revolts, unnecessary wars, unnecessary costs for the East India Company. Anyways, they have no much interest. If they are getting the money without the administration, then why do they need to? So that is something, how they establish their presence in the region. Now, what is the significance of this? From your mains point of view, see, we often say, and you would have heard before also, that the Battle of Plassey and Buxar were important because the British established their foothold into India. What you would have heard is that with the Battle of Plassey and Buxar, the British rule in India began. But that is incorrect. It is incorrect to say that the British rule in India began with the Battle of Plassey and Buxar. It is more correct to say that the British only established their presence in the region substantively with the Battle of Plassey and Buxar. Because it is nowhere, they were nowhere close to becoming a pan-Indian power at this point of time. They are only becoming a major entity. Yes, they have established their presence because they have defeated one of the most prosperous Mughal states. So they established their presence in the region. But there are other powerful regional states also. There are Marathas. We'll see this later. Marathas are also there at this point of time. And in fact, the territorial extent of the Marathas is the largest in the early 1760s, till the 1760s, till the Third Battle of Panipat. Or there is Mysore also. So there are powerful regional states like Mysore, like Marathas, which were also significant players. So it is not clear that the British are going to rule India in either 1757 or 1764. It is not clear. But what becomes clear is that they are a major player. But only now that we have a benefit of hindsight, we say ki with Battle of Plassey or Battle of Buxar, the British rule in India began. It is nowhere clear. Yes, what began was partly British indirect rule only in portions of Bengal. That is there. Okay. That is what is the significance of the Battle of Plassey and Buxar. Okay. Anything on one more significance, on one or two more points about significance that you must know, is that from Battle of Plassey and Buxar, what are they getting? A substantial financial benefit, right? And the East India Company's finances received a huge benefit from the Battle of Plassey and Buxar. And the finances received from here were partly used to compensate for what? The cost of wars that the East India Company was to fight. The cost of wars, the East India Company was fighting wars, I told you, in Hyderabad also. See, East India Company meaning East India Company is involved in the wars in Hyderabad also. It is involved in the wars in Bengal also. So part of the revenue generated from the Plassey plunder or by getting revenue collecting rights in Bengal is giving the revenue which will help them fund their wars in India. I will talk about the relationship between the East India Company and the army separately. Okay, or if you want, I'll just explain this here. That what do you see is that the British army was deployed in the region to fight wars, right? It is deployed even in the Battle of Buxar. Now, to protect the interest of whom? The British East India Company, right? But why should they protect the interest of one private trading company, one private British trading company, by going all the way to India? Why? Yes, there is rivalry between the English and the French. That is one thing. But what else? To establish their empire. They were being? Yes. They were being paid for that. In the sense that the British East India Company agreed to pay to the British Parliament an annual dividend of roughly equivalent to 376,000 pounds a year. So roughly around 376,000 pounds a year would be paid as an annual dividend by the British East India Company to the British Parliament. In return for what? The British Army supporting the British East India Company. So, if the British East India Company has to pay a budgetary support to the British Parliament, देखिए budget British Parliament को पैसा जा रहा है मतलब किसी politician की जेब में नहीं जा रहा है, it is going to the budget, okay? So, in return for this budgetary support that British East India Company extended to the British Parliament is assuring the support of the British Army to the East India Company in India. But how does the East India Company pay this amount? Partly from war compensations. Or from the revenue collecting rights from Bengal. So in a way, the financial gains made by the British East India Company from Plassey as well as from Buxar were partly used to fund the maintenance of British troops, or fund the fighting of wars by the East India Company in India. That's another significance. There is one more thing, okay, and this is something that I have not explained till now. I'll just explain and then we'll write. The imposition of war compensation. See, the point is that always a winner will impose terms on the loser, okay? And I mean, even in times of British, even in times of Mughals, etc., the Mughals would also impose conditions on the defeated parties, okay? So obviously, in terms of the victorious, see, why are you fighting war? There is an objective with which everybody is fighting war. This objective can vary from place to place. Now, the East India Company is not seeking territorial concessions, right? Because it does not wish to establish a direct rule at any point of time. So, what it is seeking is financial gains. That is why it is imposing these conditions. The Mughals sought to impose or take territorial gains. We will see Marathas, they also sought financial gains. So, every winner in a war would try to seek gains according to their own interest. So, here they are seeking financial gains. Marathas, for example, sought financial gains. The Mughals sought more territorial gains. So, that depended on the approach of each of these ruling parties. That is there. And we will discuss, for example, when we discuss Marathas, you will see that. Now, one of the things also as an impact that we not talked about here and we can talk about is a shift in the nature of trade that happens as a result of Buxar. Okay, a shift in the nature of trade between the East India Company and Indian traders. ये पॉइंट मैं इसलिए भी बता रहा हूँ क्योंकि ऐसा भी आपको प्रीलिम्स में वो क्वेश्चन भी देख सकते हैं कि विद रिस्पेक्ट टू द बैटल ऑफ बक्सर विच ऑफ द फॉलोइंग स्टेटमेंट्स आर ट्रू दैट देयर वाज अ शिफ्ट इन द नेचर ऑफ ट्रेड. नाउ व्हाट डू यू मीन बाय दिस? बेसिकली सी आई टोल्ड यू इंडियन ट्रेडर्स वर सेलिंग गुड्स टू द ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी विच वॉज सेलिंग इट गुड्स इन यूरोप. नाउ there's something that I did not tell you, and this is something which is pretty obvious, is that there is something that's called the balance of trade. Balance of trade depends on if suppose Indian how much amount of export Indian traders or how much amount of worth of goods Indian traders are selling to your East India company and how much amount of goods it is importing from East India company. If the Indian traders are exporting more than importing, then that is a positive balance of trade in whose favor? Indian favor, or in the favor of, so if there is this, then the balance of trade is in the favor of Indian traders. Now international trade at this point of time used to happen in gold. International trade at this time used to happen in bullion or gold. Okay, international trade at this time used to happen in bullion or gold, and if it was happening in bullion or gold, then if we are exporting more, so we are getting gold, and we are importing, so we have to give gold. Net balance of bullion or gold is in whose favor? Indian traders. So this trading activity was beneficial for Indian traders, and it resulted in a net influx of bullion in where? In India, right? It resulted in a net influx of bullion in India. So what is this? This is Sone Ki Chidiya. That is why we used to say that we are exporters. For example, we were the world's biggest textile exporter at this point of time. So there is a net influx of gold into India. But once the East India Company wins in the Battle of Buxar, they are generating what? They are generating revenue from Bengal. Now with this revenue from Bengal, the East India Company now would buy goods from Indian producers and Indian traders. They anyways had the monopoly of doing trade, right? And now they are using the revenue generated from Bengal to buy the goods from Indian producers and Indian traders, meaning that they are no longer paying them in bullion. So they could either buy directly from Indian producers now, or even if they were buying from Indian traders, they were paying them from the revenue generated from Bengal. So they need not bring bullion or hard currency to pay for their trading activities. Now you will say, sir, aap to usse kya farak pad raha hai? They still have to pay. Are ultimately they are using the revenue generated from Bengal to buy goods, and then they'll sell it in Europe. So basically, ultimately it is doing what? Ultimately they are increasing their profits, and most importantly, they don't have to spend gold. Why? Because till a long period of time, currencies were always pegged against gold. देखिए, एक आपको interesting बात बताता हूँ, थोड़ा सा. जीवन में interest भी बहुत जरूरी है, और UPSC में भी आना चाहिए interest, थोड़ा थोड़ा. That one of the things is that when you look at a, if I tear a piece of paper from your copy and write, this is 1 crore. You will say 2 crore. Right? What is the worth of a piece of paper? Nothing. But that is what you all give a worth to. Ultimately, you have a 100 rupee note or a 500 rupee note or a 2000 rupee note. That is something that is assumed to have a worth of its own, when in reality it does not. Right? In reality, it has no worth of its own. Historically, till the 1970s, a country would issue a currency only on the basis of amount of gold it had. Why gold? Why currencies were pegged against gold? Why do you think? Intrinsic value of gold. Patthar hai, patthar. Phek ke maroge, yehi intrinsic value hai. Why? demand. Okay, demand, because there is demand for gold. Come? Most importantly, that is partly what you're saying is true. Rather than demand or having an intrinsic value of its own, it is not availability, it is constancy. That the amount of gold is almost fixed. You can't make gold. Alchemists historically have always tried to make gold. Why? Because making gold is impossible. Or you can only make it under nuclear fusion or those kinds of technologies which nobody has. Right? So making gold is almost impossible, and the total amount of gold on earth is fixed. So if something is fixed, meaning you can't add something to it or somebody can take out something to it. So gold becomes one of those things which apart from looking attractive, I mean, if golden can look attractive, anything can look attractive is my viewpoint anyways. But nonetheless, if that is the case also, it is something which is constant, and that is why nobody can change it. If nobody can change it, it has an intrinsic value of its own. It is fixed. That is why Bitcoin. Why is Bitcoin a currency? Is because you can't make a Bitcoin of your own. It has to be the next prime number. Only there are a certain number of fixed number of Bitcoins today. You can't be mining many more. It's almost stabilized as a currency. Right? So one thing for a currency to be fixed is, aisa nahi hai ki aapne apna note chhap liya. Okay? And that must have a certain amount of value, and it must be honored by all parties. Gold was honored by all parties in international trade because everybody knew that it is fixed in amount. So that is why gold was very crucial. Having pieces of iron, pieces of copper did not mean anything as long as they could not be bartered with gold. So gold was the ultimate commodity to own, the real signifier of wealth. Now this entry into India stopped after the Battle of Buxar. Okay, after the Battle of Buxar, the British are no longer bringing in bullion from outside India to buy goods from India. Rather, they are using the revenue generated from Bengal to further finance their trading activities in Bengal. And so that is also the significance of Battle of Buxar. There is a shift in the nature of trade, meaning what? Partly that no longer the flow of bullion happened into India, and also the revenue generated from Bengal is being used for further expanding the trading activities and also for financing their military expansion in other areas. That is the significance of these battles. Is this point clear? Why did it not happen after the Battle of Plassey? Because in the Battle of Plassey, they are not getting the revenue from Bengal. So it is not. See, yes, I'll tell you this also. If you just, you're asking, so I'm telling, it's not required at your examination level. It's okay to know also. For example, Farrukh Siyar had granted certain minting rights, certain coin minting rights to the East India Company. But this was later revoked by Muhammad Shah, and more importantly, Muhammad Shah also did not revoke it. He was also in favor of continuing it. But Murshid Kuli rejected granting them any coin minting rights. Though Farrukh Siyar had granted them, and Muhammad Shah had also talked about continuing them, but Murshid Kuli refused to obey them. And that is why this was never effectively that they were getting any revenue rights. It is only after Buxar that they are actually getting revenue collection rights from Bengal.
It is the same thing like we call it
as Dastak. Dastak is a different thing. Dastak is the private trading rights. Dastaks were, dekhiye kya hai, abhi East India, just because you're asking, so I'm telling. Exam mein, I don't think so anybody is going to ask you. But misuse of Dastaks also is often cited as a reason for these wars breaking out. What was Dastak? Dastak was private trading right. East India Company would come and it would get trading rights. Or for the trade that they would do, their trade would be taxed. Okay. But in addition to, so East India Company officials would come to do trade. But they would say ki agar hum East India ke company ke liye khareed rahe hain to apne liye bhi khareed rahe hain, hum individually bhi trade kar lenge. So if we are buying on behalf of East India Company, 1000 tons, 5 tons we will buy on our behalf only, take it in the same ship and sell it privately in Europe. So this was private trade. So, but the East India Company had to pay taxes on the trade that it was doing. But a large number of these East India Company officials were indulging in this parallel trade. That was almost corruption. And it was leading to a loss of revenue for the local rulers in India also. So they decided to crack down on this. And only to selective individuals, tax-free trading rights were extended. These were called as dastaks. Okay. So dastaks is a different thing. This is a different thing. Is that clear? Anything else? Anything more you want to ask? You can think of it, ask later also. Yeah. Huh. Huh. It is not. It is the siege of Arcot. Ruk jaiye na. Abhi aaye to wahan. Hyderabad pe jab aayenge, it is often sometimes argued, he is saying, and it is rightly said, that it is often sometimes argued that it is not the Battle of Plassey with which the British established their presence in India. It was perhaps in Hyderabad in 1751, in the siege of Arcot, okay, that they actually established their presence. So, wo pehle jab hum Hyderabad aayenge, to wahan main bataunga ye baat.
It was a conspiracy or something
like that. So, the Battle of Plassey is not merely a, is not actually a battle, it is merely a skirmish. It is basically a military coup. Because ultimately there is no fighting which is happening. His army of Siraj is itself disobeying his orders. And army of Siraj is disobeying his orders, there is a military coup. There is no actual bloodletting, there is no actual fighting which is happening in the Battle of Plassey. It's not. It's so, for example, it is nothing like this that you're right in thinking if he's, they're fighting the central Mughal ruler, Shah Alam II, and Shah Alam II is getting defeated. Then isn't it that the British have defeated the Mughals in India? See, the problem with this assumption, firstly, what happened to Shah Alam II after this? Shah Alam II is taken into a house arrest for 2 months and he is later released. And Shah Alam II is replaced, he's forced to retire and he's replaced by the next Mughal ruler. Okay. It does not mean that Mughal rule ended. Nominal Mughal rule continued for another 100 years till 1857, till Bahadur Shah Zafar. Okay. So that is something that does not end here. Okay. And the British also, so they are defeating the central Mughal ruler, but that does not mean defeating the Mughal Empire in India, because I already told you that the Mughal Empire is itself becoming redundant in the sense that power is passing on to the autonomous provinces of Bengal and Hyderabad or Awadh. So it is better to argue which areas of the Mughal Empire, erstwhile Mughal Empire, are getting subdued, rather than saying ki just because the central Mughal ruler is getting defeated, the Mughal Empire is defeated, because the Mughal Empire already has given birth to successor states much before this has happened. Clear? Okay. Now, let's write this much, and that brings us to the end of Bengal. We start with Hyderabad after this. So, we have written till 1750. 1757 Plassey plunder we were writing out. One more point you write in that. Point number C is that, dekhe, prelims mein they can give you a question like this, that with respect to Battle of Buxar, which of the following statements are true? That after the battle, the British granted trading monopoly rights to the East India Company was granted trading monopoly rights in Bengal and Awadh. Okay. Or the revenue collecting rights from Bengal were granted. Okay. Or one more statement, and they'll ask you which of these statements are true. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3. So revenue collecting rights for Awadh was granted after which battle? Battle of Plassey or Buxar? None bhi ek cheez hai jeevan mein. Hai na? Revenue collecting rights from Awadh are not granted anywhere. Maine kahin bola hi nahi. It is only for Bengal, that is granted after Buxar. ओके सो एंड सो इसीलिए स्टेटमेंट्स को थोड़ा सा ध्यान से भी पढ़ना होता है. ऐसे नहीं कि आधा स्टेटमेंट सही है तो पूरा ऑटोमेटिकली सही हो जाएगा. सो जस्ट कीप दैट इन माइंड. And when I say previous year's papers, do not get into this habit of doing 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, 25 years. जब से चालू है तभी से चालू हो जाइए ना. इतने पे भी क्यों रुक रहे? बस 5 साल. The last 5 years or 6 years since the pattern has changed. And आप उसमें भी देखेंगे कि pattern keeps changing. So all I'm trying to say is that don't go beyond last 4 or 5 years. Not required. Either in prelims nor in mains. 5 years papers are more than enough. Bas utna hi dekhiye. Okay? Because unnecessary you will keep digging in the past, you will get more and more factual questions. Till 2010 in history they used to ask more factual questions. Now after 2012-13 they've been asking more conceptual questions rather than very strictly factual questions. Or especially not dates and all. They're not asking any dates. Even if they're asking factual questions, they're not asking dates. Okay? So that is why I'm saying, अगर आपने previous year के questions देखने, just look at the post past 4 or 5 years. That's it. Now, so point number C there, just write the trading monopoly. In Bengal was granted to the trading monopoly rights in Bengal was granted to the East India Company, right? After the in the Plassey plunder, after the Battle of Plassey. Okay, so and we have already written that Mir Jafar is replaced by Mir Qasim. In 1760, Mir Qasim tried to cobble up a joint Mir Qasim tried to cobble up a joint military offensive against joint military offensive with Awadh, Shuja-ud-Dawla and the central Mughal ruler Shah Alam II. And the central Mughal ruler Shah Alam II to overthrow the British presence from the region. Okay. In 1764, the Battle of Buxar, was triggered, in which the joint forces of Mughal successor states in which the joint forces of the Mughal successor states were defeated
by
the East India Company
or in bracket the British forces. Following which, in 1765, you see is the Treaty of
Allahabad.
Ultimately, Diwani rights are granted. So, आपको ये याद रखना है that ultimately Diwani rights are granted. So, the Nizamat continued with the native rulers. But, yes, so the देखिए जो governor है वही निजाम है. Governor ही निजाम है. So, Nizamat continues with the native rulers. That is the governorship. That is continuing with the native rulers. Okay? Yes, in terms of the deputy were the Diwani rights. The deputy or the in terms of appointment, and a British resident was also posted in the court of Bengal after this, who would oversee the collection of Diwani and Diwani rights. So that he was the deputy. So yes, in a way you can also see that in terms of appointment of the deputy, that was a power that went to the British. That is also something that you can argue. There is no problem with that. Yes. So, in terms of the Treaty of Allahabad, in 1765 we say that with this treaty, the British introduced the dual system of administration or indirect rule The British introduced the dual system of administration or indirect rule in Bengal, where they were granted revenue collecting rights or Diwani rights. Second is trading monopoly in Awadh region was extended to the trading monopoly in Awadh region was extended to the British East India Company. Was extended to the British East India Company. Third, the trading monopoly in Awadh region was extended to the British East India Company. Third, was apart from the trading monopoly, the third thing that they're getting is that Awadh was forced to pay a war compensation of
22.5 million rupees in Awadh was forced to pay a war compensation of 22.5 million rupees in sorry my bad of 5 million rupees after the battle. And fourthly, the nature of trade shifted after the Battle of Buxar as the East India Company used the revenue generated from Bengal to finance their trading activities in the region. Thus, the influx of bullion stopped hereafter. Thus, the influx of bullion stopped hereafter. So, all of these are the impacts that we have talked about, right? So this is also something that you must know. Now, that by and large brings us to an end, okay? In terms of significance, we say it is the beginning of the indirect rule, a shift in the nature of trade. The British are using their finances, the revenue generated from Bengal, to further expand their trading activities and partly pay for also the wars that they were fighting in the region. Okay, so that is why these are usually beneficial wars for the British. First, the Battle of Plassey was not really a war in itself, and here, even though there is a war, it brings huge financial gains for the British. That much is clear. Okay, now the next thing that we are talking about is Hyderabad. Okay. Now, the next thing that we are going to talk about is we will talk about Hyderabad. Just give me a minute. So when we talk about Hyderabad, देखिए हिस्ट्री को इंटरेस्टिंग बनाने के लिए एक और चीज का यूज किया जा सकता है वीडियोस. So we'll probably watch some relevant exam based videos probably from the next class onwards when we've covered some portion, and we'll also talk about answer writing in a while. Now, firstly, starting from Hyderabad, what is important to know in Hyderabad, there is a very good possibility of a question coming in your mains examination. Okay? Why? Because Hyderabad was one of those regions in which there was a bitter standoff between the English and the French. And it is because many historians argue that it is because the English defeated the French in Hyderabad. That is why, as the French were driven out of the region, that India became a British colony and not a French one. Okay, so that is also something that you must you know, kind of. That is why this region is very important and significant. That if the British were to be defeated in Hyderabad and the French were to consolidate their hold, then probably the history of this region would have looked very different. How different? I don't know. But it would have looked different. Okay. Now, from your examination point of view, yahan do teen cheeze hai jo important hai. Firstly, causes and the significance of what? Anglo-Carnatic Wars. Now, what do we mean by Carnatic and all? I'll explain. Okay. Then, the causes and significance of the Anglo-Carnatic Wars, and also they can ask you about the Anglo-French rivalry. Aisa ek question aa sakta hai. And what kind of a question can come from here, I'll tell you. This is the kind of expected question that they can give. That the English and the French rivalry played out in India or in the Indian subcontinent, to be more precise, in not just Hyderabad, but it also played out in Bengal, right? That rivalry was there in Bengal also, but it played out most acutely in Hyderabad. It was also there in Mysore. Okay, we'll see that also. So the Anglo-French rivalry was in many places in the Indian subcontinent. So they can ask you a question like this, that to what extent the Anglo-French rivalry in 18th century shaped the history of the Indian subcontinent. Okay, so that is a kind of a question, because that also links world history and Indian history together. So we'll discuss this later. And in Hyderabad, we'll see a big example of it. Also, they can ask you a question about the siege of Arcot. The siege of Arcot is actually one of the battles in the Second Anglo-Carnatic War, and that happened in 1751. Now, siege of Arcot is considered pretty important, because many historians argue that it was in this battle that the British imposed a crushing defeat on French, after which the French started declining, and that is why more important than the Battle of Plassey is the Battle of Arcot or the siege of Arcot, and we'll talk about it in more detail. So, ye do teen cheeze aapke liye important hai. Mostly the topic is important from mains point of view, not that much from prelims point of view. Okay. Now, so we'll talk about this. Now, firstly, to talk about Hyderabad as a region. Dekhe, firstly, to talk about Hyderabad as a region, one or two things about the background of Hyderabad you must know. Firstly, in Hyderabad, some geographical terms you must know, so that then it becomes easier. And I've put a map also in the PowerPoint presentation, but that is so you'll find that map when we'll discuss Mysore in the PowerPoint presentation, but I'm just explaining it to you here. So one was Bengal, right? One was Bengal, but below Bengal was Hyderabad, and below Hyderabad was the Carnatic region. The Carnatic region, aapne Carnatic music ka naam suna hai, right? Madras, Carnatic, right? This is the Carnatic region, the coastal region of, what you understand today is Tamil Nadu. The coastal region of that is what is Hyderabad, okay? Now, the coastal region of what is Tamil Nadu today is the Carnatic region that we talk about. Now, Hyderabad was under the Nawabship, and we'll talk about that, under the Nizamat of, we'll talk about it. Hyderabad, one of the coastal territories of Hyderabad, not extending into Bengal, but one of the coastal territories of Hyderabad was the northern Sarkars. Okay, the northern Sarkars were one of the coastal territories of the Hyderabad state. This was also partly agriculturally a fertile region, because again the rivers coming here making deltas, etc. Okay,
So this was there because we'll be using these terms in Hyderabad. This is happening in Northern Sarkar. This is happening in Carnatic region. This is happening. So you must know at least ye hai kaan paper pe, right? So that is there. Now in Hyderabad, we'll see that I told you about Asif Jahan I, right? And I told you that in 1724, Asif Jahan I becomes the Nizam of Hyderabad. So he's becoming the Nizam of Hyderabad in 1724, and he remains the Nizam of Hyderabad for the next 24 years till his death in 1748. Okay, that is there. Now one more thing. Just like there was a Nizam of Hyderabad, there was also a Nawab in the Carnatic region. This Carnatic region also partly came under the Mughal control for some time, and just like there was a governor for Hyderabad who has the title of Nizam, the governor of Bengal had the title of Nawab. Again here he has the, in the Carnatic region, the governor has the title of Nawab. Okay, so the Nawab of Carnatic region was also autonomous, but on paper he was supposed to report to the Nawab of Hyderabad. To the Nizam of Hyderabad, he was supposed to report. But just like the Nizam of Hyderabad had become autonomous, he had also become autonomous. Okay. So this is one thing that you must know as a background just. But apart from Hyderabad, one of the major challengers of Hyderabad in this region, with whom they often had frequent disputes, were two other states. Which are the two other states with which Hyderabad is going to have frequent disputes? Mysore and all three of them had competition amongst them for control of the Deccan region. Okay, this is also something that you must know as a background. Okay, so they had conflicts and competition amongst themselves for the control of the Deccan region. Okay, this point is clear. Now the next thing, within Hyderabad region, the first to establish amongst the British and French, who was the first to establish amongst the British and French to establish the trading position in Hyderabad? French. The French. The French were the first to establish their trading positions in the Hyderabad region and what you may know as Pondicherry, right? So, हाँ, पॉन्डिचेरी टुडे उसके तीन चार पार्ट्स हैं, ये है वो है. वी आर ओनली टॉकिंग अबाउट पॉन्डिचेरी एज द सिटी एंड द विलेजेस अराउंड पॉन्डिचेरी. दे वर ग्रांटेड टू फ्रेंच. ओके, दे वर ग्रांटेड टू फ्रेंच एंड द विलेजेस अराउंड पॉन्डिचेरी ऑल्सो दे वर ग्रांटेड टू द फ्रेंच. ओके, एंड द फ्रेंच वर द प्रेडोमिनेंट हु हैड एस्टैब्लिश्ड द प्रेजेंस इन दिस रीजन बिफोर द ब्रिटिश अराइव्ड इन द हैदराबाद region. Okay, the British arrived later after the French had established their presence in the region, in this region. I'm not saying overall in India, I'm saying in Hyderabad region. Now what is important here, so this is another background you need to know. Now another thing from the background that you need to know as we move forward is something about the Anglo-French rivalry. We will see that there are three Anglo-Carnatic wars, okay? 1740 to 1748, first, okay? Dekhe, main bhi batata hu. There are three Anglo-Carnatic wars, 1740 to 48, then 1749 to 53, then 1754 to 1763, or in some books it's mentioned as 1757 to 1763. There are three wars. Three Anglo-Carnatic wars are there. Now, from your examination point of view, if when they ask you the causes of the Anglo-Carnatic wars and their significance, we are going to approach it in this fashion of the causes of the first Anglo-Carnatic war, the cause of the second, and the cause of the third. I will briefly tell you what happened in these wars, not too much. and please don't try to mug it up because aapke hoga bhi nahi. Okay, isme itne log hain, itne naam hain, kisne kisko mara, yahi chalta rahega. Aap, if you keep trying to mug up that, it's not going to be relevant from your examination point of view also. What you need to focus more on are the causes and the significance. Now, I am talking about the first war first. Okay. Now, in terms of talking about the first war, what we should firstly know is that this war did not happen in the Hyderabad region. It happened in the Carnatic region. Okay. This happened in the Carnatic region. Now, and this is happening from 1740 to 48. But before we understand what happened in the war, and to understand what triggered the war, one has to understand that the Anglo-French rivalry was happening in three different arenas at this point of time. You can draw this with me. Okay, this is only for understanding, but it will ease your understanding. Okay, that the Anglo-French rivalry was in three areas. One, it was in North America. Both British and the French government had a colonial presence in North American continent. Okay, the British were more present in the eastern coast of North America, whereas the French were present more on the western coast and portions of Canada. Okay, or North American continent, yes, I know Canada comes. I'm just emphasizing that Canada also was involved in this situation. So that is, in North America, there was a competition between the British and the French to expand their colonial presence. There was also a competition in Europe, and this was over the succession dispute in the Austrian Empire, or what was called the Habsburg Empire at this point of time. What was this dispute? Isme kya tha? That there were two rival groups. There were two rival claimants to the throne of the Habsburg Empire, and we don't need to get into its detail because I'm European history nahi padh rahe. Okay. All we need to know is that there were two rival claimants to the throne within the family of the Habsburg Empire, and these two rival groups were supported by the British and the French. Why? Because if their supported faction was to come to power, it would increase the influence of the British or the French in Europe or in continental Europe. Okay. So yeah, bhari shabd ho gaya, proxy war, wahan tak nahi jate. It's only that they are intervening in the succession dispute. Okay. They are intervening in the succession dispute. Matlab ye aap to fir aise keh diya ki agar India ne matlab Maldives mein agar Nasheed ko support kar diya, to we are fighting a proxy war. Bhari shabd, proxy war nahi kehte. So, what we are saying is here that it is a succession dispute within Europe in the Habsburg Empire, and both British and French are supporting rival claimants to the throne of the Habsburg Empire in Austria. Why? Because both want to increase their influence in Europe as well. And thirdly, I'll have to draw again. So thirdly it is in South India or the Indian subcontinent, to be more precise, where again the British East India Company and the French East India Company are involved, right? And this is all happening at the same time in 1740 to 1760. 23 years of war fighting, okay, almost happening at the same time, and this continues in the, yes, the Europe matter was solved in 1748. It gets solved in 1748. The succession dispute gets solved in 1748, but the conflict in North America and in the Indian subcontinent, it continued in from 1740 till 1763. So we should know firstly that they are simultaneously engaged in wars in both the places. Okay, that is one thing to know. Now, let's talk about what happened in the war, okay, or in the first war. It is very easy to understand that what happened in the first war is What happened in the first war is that in South India, the war broke out in the Carnatic region. In Carnatic region, the French already had the trading presence in Hyderabad. In the Carnatic region, it is the British who are now trying to establish their trading presence. The British are trying to establish their trading presence in the Carnatic region. And as the British try to establish their trading presence in the Carnatic region, who is not going to like it? French. Because the French are looking to consolidate their presence in the region. And here, at this point of time, one of the important military commanders who is in charge of the French army is Dupleix. Dupleix is the French military general who is in charge of the French affairs, and he is clear that he wants to establish the predominant hold of France in this whole region and control the coast and also the ports in the region. So, he is determined to keep the British out of the region, and that is also something that Dupleix is determined about. And as the British try to establish their presence in the Carnatic region, the French are not very happy about this whole development. So, what is going to happen? War. Right. It is as simple as that a war is impending as the British try to establish their presence in the region. And as the British try to establish their presence in the trading presence in the Carnatic region, they will need what? Trading rights. So, the Nawab of Carnatic granted the British trading rights in the region, in the Carnatic region. So, if the Nawab of Carnatic at this point of time was Nawab Anwaruddin, name up, not that important to remember. Okay. Nawab Anwaruddin was the Nawab of Carnatic in this region. He had granted the British East India Company trading rights in Carnatic region. Now, Hyderabad, now the French do not like this one bit. And as the British start establishing the trading presence in the Carnatic region, it is the French who attack the British trading positions in Carnatic. The French attacked the British trading positions in Carnatic region. Now, the French East India Company is supported by the French army, and the British East India Company is supported by nobody. In the beginning of 1740, the British East India Company does not have the support of the British army. Now, this leaves them desperate, because without the British army's support, they are unable to defend themselves against the French army. So, they approach whom? They approach the Nawab of Carnatic for help. They approach the Nawab of Carnatic for help that you should offer us military protection. The Nawab agreed to offer protection to the Nawab agreed to offer protection to the British. And as the Nawab agreed to offer protection to the British now breathed with some relief that they have some protection. However, in this war, in this prolonged war which was happening, the French eventually defeated the Nawab of Carnatic. The French eventually defeated the Nawab of Carnatic and captured the British trading positions in the Carnatic region. Then they say ki Anwaruddin ho gaya tumhara. So Dupleix says that the time for Anwaruddin is up, because he has rallied with the British. He seems more sympathetic towards the British than towards the French. It is time to drive out Anwaruddin from the region. So what will happen? Assassination, right? Change of power, change of ruler. So Anwaruddin is assassinated, and a prominent noble in the court of Anwaruddin, Chand Sahib, is placed on the throne of Carnatic region. Chand Sahib is to be placed on the throne of Carnatic region. Okay. And we'll write this in a minute. So this is what happened in Carnatic. But what about, it seems that the French have defeated the British, right? So who is winning, the French or the British? The French. In the first Anglo-Carnatic war, it seemed that the French were on the offensive and the French were winning. But only in South India. While the French captured British trading positions in Carnatic region in 1748, the British captured French colonies in North America. Yeah, the British captured French colonies in North America. So in the first war, it is the British who are winning. It is the British who are winning in North America, and it is the French who are winning in South India. So, what are they going to do? They'll say, "Ab pyar mohabbat se mamla kar lete." So, the British agreed to return the French colonies in North America. The French agreed to return the British trading positions in the Carnatic region. And this is something which happens with the Treaty of 1748. The Treaty of how do you pronounce it? I am not good in French. If you have read, please pronounce it however you want to do it. जैसे भी अपने मन से जो भी करना है वो कर दीजिए. AIX La Chapel. Okay, whatever. So हाँ जैसा आपको अच्छा लग रहा बोलने में वैसे आप कर लीजिए. It's up to you. So what happens with the Treaty of 1748? No need to remember the name of treaty also. Okay. With the Treaty of 1748, the British trading positions in Carnatic region are returned to them by the French, whereas the French colonies in North America are returned by the British. It is returning to the status quo of 1740. But the only net result has been that the British have managed to establish a presence in the Carnatic region, partly. Yet, also what changes is that the Nawab of Carnatic is out. Anwaruddin is removed from the scene, and Dupleix engineered a military coup. Dupleix engineered a coup in the Carnatic region. And we'll talk about that again in a minute. So this happens in the first war. So the first war is triggered by what? The first war is triggered by, again, the Anglo-French rivalry. As the British sought to expand their trading presence in the Carnatic region, which the French were unwilling to tolerate, as Dupleix and the French were willing to consolidate their hold over the region and establish their trading monopoly in the whole region. That is what triggered the first war. End result is what? That both are agreeing to a compromise with the Treaty of 1748. That is what happened in the first war. Ab aayega maza. This is like Gangs of Wasseypur, part 1. The part 2 is going to begin. Okay. So, what happens after this is interesting in the sense it is interesting as well as important. Because in the first war, in India, who's winning? The French, right? And the second war is a big turnaround, okay? And it is very important also. That is why it's a significant war, okay? That what is happening in the second war is more complicated also. The second war happens in both Hyderabad and Carnatic regions. The second war begins in Hyderabad in 1748. Why? Because Asif Jahan I dies in 1748. Asif Jahan I dies, I told you 1724 to 1748 is Asif Jahan. Asif Jahan I is a strong ruler. He was a strong prominent noble and he was a strong ruler in Hyderabad. After his death in 1748, what will happen? Succession dispute. So, succession dispute emerges in Hyderabad between his son and his grandson, Nasir Jung and Muzaffar Jung. Okay, there is a succession dispute here. In the Carnatic region in 1748, I am telling you already what, that Anwaruddin is assassinated. Anwaruddin is assassinated and Chand Sahib Anwaruddin was assassinated and Chand Sahib is placed on the throne. Chand Sahib is placed on the throne of the Carnatic region. Now, Chand Sahib is placed on the throne of the Carnatic region, but Vaseputtu mein kya hota hai? Baap ka sabka badla, right? So Anwaruddin's son is Muhammad Ali. Anwaruddin's son is Muhammad Ali. He manages to escape even though Chand Sahib is placed on the throne and it becomes the next Nawab with the support of Dupleix. So, Dupleix is providing the support with which Chand Sahib is getting placed on the throne of Karnataka. Now, what is happening here is that there is Nasir Jung and there is Muzaffar Jung. One is supported by the British, the other is supported by the French. Why are they interested? Is because if their supported individual comes to the power, then they are likely to have more trading privileges, more control, more influence in the region, right? And also to keep the rivals from their rival, that is the British wanted to keep the French out, the French wanted to keep the British out. So, British are supporting Nasir Jung, French are supporting Muzaffar Jung. Ab, kya hoga? So, Dupleix is leading the efforts for the French. And Dupleix is an able military commander. He is able to bring Chand Sahib in power in Hyderabad and Muzaffar Jung in power in
Hyderabad.
Okay. In Hyderabad. He is able to bring Chand Sahib in power in Karnataka and Muzaffar Jung in power in Hyderabad. So, and that is something that happens by 1749 itself. By 1749, again, who is winning? The French. The French supported contestants come to power in both Hyderabad and Carnatic region. In return for the valuable French support in Hyderabad, the Nawab of Hyderabad now grants Northern Sarkars as a Jagir to the French. Northern Sarkars was granted as a Jagir to the French for their important support. Okay. So the French are clearly the more dominating power by 1749. But then comes the twist in the story, and the twist comes with Muhammad Ali. That Muhammad Ali, with British support, firstly, in 1751, Muhammad Ali, with British support, is able to do what? Is able to assassinate Chand Sahib. Okay. And captures the throne of Carnatic region. In 1751, this key battle in which Muhammad Ali defeats the French and the forces of Chand Sahib together with British assistance is what? Is the Battle of Arcot, or is the Battle of Arcot, or what is also called as the Siege of Arcot. Arcot is modern day Vellore, right? Yeah,
In the sense, yes, Arcot is the major seat of power at this point of time. So, the Battle of Arcot in 1751 is one in which the now Muhammad Ali is turning the tables on Chand Sahib and the French, and with the British support, he captures the Carnatic region. This is where you see that the French are defeated in a significant way, in a significant manner at this time. This is where you see is a turnaround where the French are getting defeated from the British. Now, complex series of things happened. Muzaffar Jung also actually died in the war, because there's a war fighting here also happening. Okay, Muzaffar Jung also died, and Nasir Jung's descendants are placed on the throne of the Carnatic, throne of the Hyderabad region. So, in the Battle of Arcot, as firstly Muhammad Ali imposes a defeat on the French in Carnatic, similarly the descendants of Nasir Jung came to power by 1753 in Hyderabad. So what is happening by the end of the Second War? The tables have turned. The British are now emerging victorious by the end of the Second War in both Hyderabad and Carnatic regions. Right? So, more important, many historians argue that more important than the British establishing their hold in Plassey or in Buxar in Bengal was the British establishing or the British managing to displace French by the end of, by the end of Second War. Okay. But sir, agar Second War mein end ho gaya tha French ka, toh Teesra Anglo-Carnatic War kyun hua? It's not that it has ended. It is that they are on the back foot. And the French are pushed on the back foot by the end of the Second War. Now, though the French are pushed on the back foot, here, kahani abhi baki. The French are pushed on the back foot here. But it is here that now the French are imposing significant military defeats on the British in North America. So, in North America, the French are able to capture some colonies from British. And here, the British are able to capture some colonies, the British are able to increase their influence in Hyderabad and Carnatic region. So, what will happen again? Peace. Peace has to return again. But in this peace, the British had a higher negotiating power, upper negotiating hand. And the British demanded that the British said that we will return the French trading positions in Hyderabad and Carnatic region. We will return all the territories we have captured from the French, provided Dupleix is taken out of
India.
Okay? Because Dupleix is the one who nurtured deep personal ambitions. Dupleix had invested, had made huge profits from French trade here, and Dupleix had invested this profit to buy more property also in the region. So he was deeply invested, and he intended to extend the French influence even further. He was the one who's doing all this, you know, scheming to ultimately bring about transfer of power or engineer succession disputes or intervene in succession disputes. So they argued that if Dupleix is taken out of the situation, then it will ease matters significantly. Okay? So they said that we are willing to strike a peace deal with the French if the French agree to withdraw Dupleix. So the French agreed to withdraw Dupleix after the Second War, and the British are returning the French trading positions in the Hyderabad region. And including partly the Northern Sarkars continues to stay as a jagir with the French up till this time. Okay. Now, this is something which is happening in the Second War. So, what is triggering the Second War? Two things. Again, the Anglo-French rivalry and also the succession disputes. One which emerged on its own in Hyderabad and one which was artificially introduced by Dupleix in Carnatic.
right? That is the, so this is what is triggering the second war. Up third war, the third war breaks out. The third war breaks out primarily, again, over the same issues. Not here, but it starts from North America. The war starts from North America as the British and the French were engaged in a colonial dispute there. Okay. And in this war goes on from 1754 to 1763. This is the third and the final round of decisive war between the English and the French. And what is the net outcome? This is called the 7-year war. Okay, 1754 to 1763. This is also called the 7-year war. Mujhe pata hai ki 1754 se 63 tak saat nahi jyada saal hote hain. Lekin it is called as a seven-year war because officially the war started in 1757 only. Okay, so some books it mentioned as 1754 to 63. Some places mentioned as 1757 to 63. It is called as a 7-year war, and this 20 years of war fighting, including the final round of war, it is considered by many historians that if there was a world war before World War I, it was this period of war. Where the war happened in Europe also, the conflict was there in Europe also, North America also, the Indian subcontinent also. So, in the sense that if there was a war which was truly had a global impact before World War I, it was this period of Anglo-French rivalry. In the third and the final decisive round of war, the war will end only when the same party gets defeated both in North America as well as in South India. And in the third war, it is the British who impose a decisive military defeat on the French, both in North America and in South India. Okay. And the French are defeated in both the places. And why is this important? This is important primarily because as a result of this war, and this war ended with the Treaty of Paris in 1763. The war ended with the Treaty of Paris in 1763, after which the French withdrew from South India as well as they withdrew from North America. Okay. So this is why it is a very significant period of history, where by the end of the third Anglo-Carnatic War, the Anglo-French rivalry was settled in the favor of English vis-a-vis the French in both North America as well as in the Indian subcontinent. Okay. And why is this significant? Battle of Plassey is other. It is significant primarily because of another reason. And what is that reason? The reason is, dekhe. The reason is what? The reason is that Indian states, native Indian states, could no longer rely upon or could not any longer explore the possibility of supporting the French to decrease British influence or supporting the British to decrease French influence. Aapko kyo lagta hai? That the French, why is it that Carnatic is giving the British a presence in the region? To begin with, Nawab Anwaruddin is giving the British a presence in the Carnatic region. What? Yes, self-interest. What is the self-interest? To curb the French. See, in the Carnatic region, in the first war, it is getting triggered when the British are being given a trading right. Why not give it to the French only? Primarily because if the British would be present, they would help in probably limiting the influence of French in the region. So one of the things is, this is also something that happens in world history. Aap kahin bhi dekhiye, for example, when India got independent, we said we'll maintain friendly relations with both Soviet Union and US. For example, if you look at Nepal says we want good friendly relations with India as well as China. Okay. So basically, what happens in that way? In that way, what happens is that a smaller states can often rely, could often try to rely upon one competitor to balance out the other. So as long as the French were present in the region, there was always a possibility that Indian states could join hands with French to limit British influence and vice versa. But now that the French were no longer there, the Indian states could not join hands, and more importantly, for British, the bigger challenge emerged from the French. And now that the French challenge was no longer there, they could simply concentrate on the Indian states. देखिए ऐसे समझ लीजिए, ऐसे भी नहीं आ रहा है. इंडिया है, इंडिया के लिए दो हेडेक हैं, एक इज चाइना एंड ए पाकिस्तान. राइट, सो इफ देयर आर टू मेजर इश्यूज, इफ देन पाकिस्तान कैन यूज चाइना टू बैलेंस आउट इंडिया. ओके, सो इन दैट कॉन्टेक्स्ट, इफ देयर इज नो चाइना एंगल, देन तो हम चाय और नाश्ता हो ही जाए. राइट, नाउ दैट इज क्लियर. सो देखिए, दैट इज वाई आई से हिस्ट्री इज नथिंग, इट इज इंटरनेशनल रिलेशंस. ये क्या है, हम आईआर ही तो पढ़ रहे हैं. राइट, सो वॉर्स एंड डिप्लोमेसी इज ऑलवेज वेरी क्लोजली रिलेटेड. ओके, सो इन दैट कॉन्टेक्स्ट, दिस इज व्हाट इज हैपनिंग हियर, दैट विद नो लॉन्गर अ फ्रेंच प्रेजेंस इन द रीजन, द ब्रिटिश आर अश्योर्ड दैट नाउ दे कैन डील विद इंडियन स्टेट्स इन अ रिलेटिवली इजियर मैनर, एंड दिस विल हेल्प इन कंसोलिडेटिंग द ब्रिटिश presence in the region, and they do not have to constantly worry about the French presence in the region. That is also what is significant. Now, any doubts still here?
Sir, what about the Austrian? What happened to Austria?
What happened to Austria? Austria, the matter was settled within the Habsburg Empire. The Habsburg Empire continued to rule Austria. The earlier rulers before, for example, when we'll discuss world history, we'll discuss Austria there. When we'll talk about Habsburg Empire, Metternich, that is something which will I explain there. Okay, when we'll talk.
Did it play any role in this, like, Carnatic?
Austria is not playing any role. Austria is just becoming one of the other playing grounds where the British and French are intervening.
They were just one of the part of the journey of this Anglo-Saxon.
Yeah. See, one of the things is, Austria is not a colony of either the British or French. It is an independent power of its own. But the rival claimants to the throne were being supported by British and French. Okay? Just like in Hyderabad, right? That you are saying that Nasir Jung and Muzaffar Jung are there. So, rival claimants are being supported there also. Rival claimants are being supported there also. We are not talking about it because it's not relevant from our examination point. Anything else? आप सब इतने शांत क्यों हैं? इतना शांत रहना अच्छा नहीं, अभी तो शुरुआत है. ठीक है, एक चीज़ आपको अच्छा इंटरेस्टिंग बता दूँ. हाउ मेनी ऑफ यू आर फ्रॉम इंजीनियरिंग बैकग्राउंड? ओके, लेट मी आस्क अ डिफरेंट क्वेश्चन. हाउ मेनी ऑफ यू नॉट फ्रॉम इंजीनियरिंग और मेडिकल बैकग्राउंड? सो देखिए, आपके लिए नहीं है ये जो मैं बोलने वाला हूँ. जिनका पहला हाथ उठाता है उनके लिए. सो see what happens is कि जब हम UPSC की तैयारी करने आते हैं, एंड दिस में पार्टली अप्लाई टू जिन्होंने बाद में भी हाथ उठाया उनके लिए भी, बट जिन्होंने पहले उठाया उनके लिए डेफिनेटली है. दैट व्हेन वी कम टू स्टार्ट प्रिपेयरिंग फॉर UPSC, तो वी कम फ्रॉम द सेम सोशल सर्कल. हम वहाँ थे, हमारे फ्रेंड किसी कंपनी में कहीं जॉब, MBA, कुछ बड़ी चीज़ें कर रहे हैं जीवन में, है ना. बट यू डिसाइड टू लीव एवरीथिंग एंड देन कम हियर to do even something bigger in life, or that is what you feel. So I'm just joking. So what is important is that when you start preparing, to aapko lagta hai you always have views. Jaise abhi aapka abhi bhi kuch view hoga ki kaise hum China ko sikha sakte hai ya Pakistan ko, right, ya XYZ kisi bhi cheez ko leke, you will have views, hai na. And wo view ha ya na, yahi hoga, aisa hai तो है, ऐसा नहीं है तो नहीं है. बट वन ईयर डाउन द लाइन आप अपने ही मित्रों के साथ, उनके भी व्यूज होंगे जिनको आप छोड़ आए हैं अभी पीछे, एक साल बाद उनके साथ बैठिएगा, फिर वापस कभी बात करिएगा, तो आपको रियलाइज हो जाएगा कि अब बात नहीं हो सकती. वो इसीलिए, दैट विल हैपन प्राइमरीली बिकॉज ऑफ दिस रीजन, that you will realize that there are many sides to a story. And there are often contesting views which may be held on the same thing and both may have certain grain of truth. So, ye ki nahi, ye to ho hi jayega, ye ho hi sakta hai, ye hi hai sahi. Is tarah ka viewpoint often UPSC also does not appreciate, because also in terms of either it is policy making or from your answers, we always expect ki you should bring out all the sides of the argument, not just say ki haan, mujhe ko aisa lagta hai, to aisa hoga. Okay, that is there. And also you will become more enlightened. Dekhe, mera bada simple sa kehna hai. That is why I am saying. People who come from engineering background or doctor backgrounds or some commerce background, okay, whatever you have learned in the past 22, 24, 25, 26, 28 years of your life, you will learn more than that in 1 year. Isse kya pata chalta hai aapko? Ki yahan aapko bahut gyan mil raha hai? Nahi. Isse aapko ye pata chalta hai ki pichle 28 saal aapko koi gyan nahi mila. Okay. So that is something, because college school mein kya ho raha tha? Kuch nahi ho raha tha. Right? Newton, first law of gravity, or then V is equal to U plus AT. Yehi chal. Kyo ho raha hai? Kya ho raha hai? Kuch nahi pata. Right? So that is what is happening. And so we managed to create in India a group of people who have no knowledge or and have developed no reasoning capabilities. Ye UPSC bachcha taiyari karna hai to sir answer kya hai? अरे आंसर लाने के लिए पहले यू नीड टू हैव अ बिट ऑफ एनालिटिकल एबिलिटी. और आप बचपन से क्या करते हैं? रट लो, फॉर्मूला लगाओ, आंसर आएगा. आंसर एक ही है, चार ऑप्शन है, आंसर एक ही है. देयर इज नो स्कोप ऑफ एम्बिग्युटी इन आंसर्स. बट इन यूपीएससी व्हेन यू स्टार्ट राइटिंग देयर इज ऑल एम्बिग्युटी. राइट? देयर कैन बी फोर आंसर्स एंड फोर डिफरेंट आंसर्स टू द सेम क्वेश्चन. सो यू से सर इसमें सही आंसर कौन सा है? अरे जीवन में बस एक ही चीज सही नहीं है. Not everything is physics, chemistry and maths, right? There's a whole world out of it. So UPSC will teach you also that. So 1 year at least UPSC preparation is always going to be a very enlightening experience. Isko dekhiye kya hota hai na, log taiyari karne aate hain ki isko burden ki tarah hai ki papa ne bhej diya, ghar walon ne bhej diya, ya hum nahi le liye apne upar burden expectations ka, right? So one thing is you keep trying your best, that is there, but if you are determined to learn, you will return more satisfied from here, irrespective of whatever happens. You hope for the best, you work for the best, and irrespective of whatever happens, you will return as a more enlightened individual. So, when you say something to people, that yes, it's going to happen, do you know? Then you say, yes. So, that is something that you can do. Now, something that you can do. Now, there should be a positive incentive, right? So, that is there. Now, let's start writing about Hyderabad and the Anglo-Carnatic Wars. Okay, so you can write about Hyderabad and I'll dictate. Yes, so in Hyderabad you give the heading Anglo-Carnatic Wars and its causes. You give the heading, the first Anglo-Carnatic War. First Anglo-Carnatic War. In the first Anglo-Carnatic War, basically, then you write the Anglo-French rivalry was a key trigger. Choti copy mein likhna band kar dijiye. I am saying this on for a reason. देखिए कोई भी छोटी कॉपी में मत लिखिएगा कोई भी चीज़ों के नोट्स. एक रीज़न है उसका, क्योंकि ये बाद में आपको प्रॉब्लम देगा, है ना. ऑलवेज कीप योर नोट्स ऑफ वन सब्जेक्ट. हर सब्जेक्ट की एक कॉपी होनी चाहिए, खत्म. आपके जीवन का पूरा ज्ञान उस कॉपी में आ जाना चाहिए. अगर उसके बाहर जा रहा है मतलब आपका ज्ञान आया नहीं है. देखिए व्हेन यू स्टार्ट रीडिंग अ बुक You start, when you start reading a book for the first time, you'll underline everything. And that's all important. अगर आपने को पता है कि क्या इंपॉर्टेंट है तो आप हर चीज अंडरलाइन नहीं करेंगे या हर चीज को कॉपी में नहीं उतारेंगे, है ना. दैट इज वाई कि वन कॉपी थोड़ा सा मोटा लेकिन बड़ा, एंड उसी में आप आगे जोड़ सकते हैं कई चीजें. वरना क्या होता है, आपने कुछ चीज यहां लिखा है, कुछ चीज वहां लिखा है और वो आखिरी में कभी एक जगह पे आएगा नहीं, है ना. सो एक अगर आप हिस्ट्री की कॉपी है तो उसमें सारा हिस्ट्री उसी में आ जाएगा, चाहे आपने शेखर बंदोपाध्याय से पढ़ लिया, चाहे आपने कुछ से पढ़ लिया, वहीं आ जाएगा. एंड एज आई क्लैरिफाइड बिफोर वी राइट एनी फर्दर, प्लीज रिमेंबर कि मैंने आपको कहा था कि एक ही बुक पढ़नी है आपने. अगर पढ़नी है तो एक ही बुक पढ़नी है. वेदर यू रीडिंग बिपिन चंद्रा तो बिपिन चंद्रा, अब उसके बाद एनसीईआरटी पढ़ने का कोई जरूरत नहीं, ठीक है. ऐसे नहीं कि पहले एनसीईआरटी पढ़ रहे हैं, फिर क्लास का पढ़ रहे हैं, फिर बिपिन चंद्रा पढ़ रहे हैं. यही करने को मैंने मना किया था. So that is what I'm saying. Bipin Chandra's, for example, if you're reading Orient Black Swan publication wala Bipin Chandra, then you don't read NCRT. Okay? Just read one. If you're reading Bipin Chandra, just read one version of Bipin Chandra and the class notes and the PowerPoint presentation. That is it. Aur kuch nahi padhna hai. Okay? And how do you approach reading it? Is whenever you're reading a chapter, say we have done something in the class, you pick that chapter. Okay? You read it. You find one or two points extra. You write it on a piece of paper and attach it in your notes. Once you have read that book, you should not be, when revising, you should not revise the book again. Aapko us book mein se jo mil raha hai, wo aap notes mein add kare. So that aapke paas ek jagah ho sa. That is very important from your examination. Is that clear? Right? So just keep that in mind. Wo maine aapki copy dekhi to mujhe aisa laga. Yeah. See, the problem with spectrum, that is why I don't talk about spectrum, is वो copy paste है. उन्होंने पांच जगह से उठाया, उठा के एक जगह information डाल दिया. Information is not education, right? Information is not something that will help you in analysis. हमको ये देखना है हमारे exam के लिए क्या relevant है, उस हिसाब से हमें देखना है. So, for example, that is why I'm saying Bipin Chandra. Don't, और ये जो portion है, जो नया spectrum है, उसमें बहुत ही बुरा दिया है. 1700 to 1800 is very shoddily given in that. So that is why I've been insistent ki dekhiye kya hota hai, guidebook hota hai, text hota hai, baap baap hota hai, beta hota hai, hai na. So spectrum, I don't, in my humble world view, it is not a good book at all. One should not, spectrum aapko baad mein end mein kuch dekhna hai, thoda bahut to dekh liya, warna wo ek kitab nahi hai. Na to usme language achhi milegi aapko kisi cheez ki, academic language milegi, kyunki when you read academic language then only you get familiar with it. राइट, आप अगर पावरपॉइंट प्रेजेंटेशन देखेंगे जाके तो उसमें आपको एकेडमिक लैंग्वेज मिलेगी बिल्कुल. ओके, दैट इज टेकन फ्रॉम बंदोपाध्याय और फ्रॉम वेरी स्टैंडर्ड सोर्सेज. तो मेरा सजेशन ये है कि उसमें ना घुसे. यस, एक ही जगह. यस, इट्स whatever extra facts required for prelims examination point of view, whatever are the extra facts required from your prelims examination point of view, I'll give them at the end of our discussion in one 15-20 pages to you. Aapko kahin uske liye sar phodne ki zarurat nahi. Don't try to mug up facts and add facts. Add a substantive point if you are getting. It must be a substantive point. Ye nahi ki ye painting aaj bani thi, ye add kar rahe hain aap notes mein. इसका कोई रेलेवेंस नहीं है, ऐसा क्वेश्चन पूछे ही नहीं जाते, ठीक है. सो आपको जो ऐड करना है, कोई सब्सटेंटिव पॉइंट मिल रहा है, दैट इज व्हाट यू हैव टू ऐड. क्लियर? नो नीड इट. इफ यू आर रीडिंग बंदोपाध्याय तो कोई जरूरत ही नहीं, सबसे अच्छी किताब है अभी के टाइम में. बट द प्रॉब्लम इज इट्स टू डेंस, दैट्स इट. इफ यू कैन देन देयर इज नो नीड टू रीड एनीथिंग एल्स. नाउ यू राइट. Okay, so we were writing. The Anglo-French rivalry was a key trigger for the outbreak of hostilities in the Carnatic region during the First Anglo-Carnatic War. During the First Anglo-Carnatic War. Next point within the same. As the British and French supported the rival claimants, as the British and the French supported rival claimants to the throne of Habsburg Empire, Habsburg, supported rival claimants to the throne of Habsburg Empire, the conflict spilled out in the subcontinent as well. The conflict spilled out in the subcontinent as well. Okay. The conflict spilled out in the subcontinent as well. Next point within the same. As the Nawab of Carnatic in bracket you can write Nawab Anwaruddin, Nawab Anwaruddin, bracket close, as the Nawab of Carnatic granted British trading rights in the region, the French, who already enjoyed a dominant position in Hyderabad under Dupleix, Dupleix. The French, who already enjoyed a dominant position under in Hyderabad under Dupleix, were determined to keep the French out of the region. The British out of the region. We're determined to keep the British out of the region. The French attacked. The French attacked the British trading positions. In Carnatic region,
The British approached the Nawab of Carnatic for military assistance. But in the war the forces of Nawab of Carnatic were eventually defeated. So, and at the very start, just right, this is from 1740 to 1748, at the start, where we've written the First Anglo-Carnatic War, at the top, just right, that it is from 1740 to 1748. Right? The next point within the same is, as the British suffered a setback in the Carnatic region, the French suffered setbacks in North America, following which both sides agreed to return each other's colonial possessions, and trading positions in North America and South India, or actually a precise term is Indian subcontinent. Why do we actually try to say this is subcontinent? Because there is no India technically here. Okay, so the precise term is Indian subcontinent. Lekin koi baat nahi, India mein sab chalta hai. South India. Okay, so this was the treaty of 1748. This was the treaty of 1748 or AIX La Chapelle, whatever you want to call. AIX-LA-CHAPELLE. Okay. So, this is what is the event as well as, so event bhi humne bata diya aur trigger bhi bata diya. Trigger is what? So this is what we have written in the first part of this. We have written the what is the trigger. In the second part, we have written what happened in the war. And it is ending with the treaty. Aise hi likha jata hai. Dekhiye, main aapko jo likhwa raha hu, uske likhwane ka matlab ye nahi ki main aapko notes dene ke liye nahi likhwa raha hu. I am trying to give you a kind of template. Aap poochte hai na ki kaise answer likhna hai. Answer aise likhna hota hai. That you precisely firstly say ki okay, you can divide it. So you can give a heading like this also. Giving headings is good in answer. Because it tells to the, dekhe, heading answer mein wahi insan deta hai, jisko, dekhe, jab aapko nahi pata hai, to aap likhte hai ki aisa likhna hai ki bas wo frustrate hoke number de de. Right.
When you know precisely, you will write it structured. When you don't know precisely, you will write unstructured. Okay. One of the things is when students talk about answer writing, we often ask, sir, maine pad liya, mujhe samajh mein aa gaya, lekin I am not able to write. Why does this happen? This happens because you have understood, but understood is not the same as memorizing. Okay. Both are important. Sirf samajhna hi zaruri nahi hai. Usko aapko, you will have to memorize it also. And that is why one of the best times to write an answer is after you have read some topic at least thrice. Agar aap teen baar padhenge, to aapko apne aap dimag mein points baith jayenge. Okay. Then you try to write. Sirf samajhna zaruri nahi. Kyunki aap agar yahan se jaake, you go back home and you don't revise. To yahan to aapko sab samajh mein aa gaya. Agle din sab saaf. Right. So that is why revision is very crucial. When you have revised thrice, that is when you are ready to write an answer. So in the, aap aise bhi usme kar sakte hain ki maine jo shuru ke do ya teen points likhwaye, that are the causes, uske baad are the events, then is the, that is end with the treaty of 1748, right? This is the way. Now we'll write about the impacts of these later together, okay, of the wars, we'll write about the impacts later. We'll stop here for today. In the second, about the second and the third war, we'll write in the next class and we'll end. And after that, after we end Hyderabad, we'll begin with Mysore. Any doubts still here? Enjoy.